So thank you all. It's a great pleasure to be here this morning. Even though I have been involved in state and federal government now for almost 20 years of my life, I still like to consider myself just a farmer and a rancher from central Nebraska. Our family farm, my children represent the fifth and sixth generations of both sides of our family to be involved in production agriculture in our community. And so that's those roots that kind of make me feel like I don't want to leave that farmer status. And as I served in my role as Director of Agriculture in Nebraska, as I approached regulations or I approached rules that we were going to enforce or promotional activities that we were going to embark on, I would always try to think about how that might affect those farmers and ranchers back in Sumner, Nebraska, a community of 250 people. And I hope to have continue to bring that mentality of thinking about the individual farmers and ranchers in our small communities and rural areas across America that are impacted each and every day by the decisions that USDA is making. And I really feel like the team that Secretary Perdue has the ability to do that. Bill Northey still has his roots in a family farm in Iowa. Ted McKinney's family still owns and operates farmland in Indiana. Steve Senske's family comes from Minnesota and he went to South Dakota to school. So all very much tied in rural Midwest America and very much interested in their listening to their families back home on their family farms and ranches. You know, I'm very appreciative of the ability to be able to hear and talk to you, be here and talk to you today. Your organization plays an important role in animal agriculture and will be an important partner for USDA as we work together on issues across animal agriculture, but especially on animal disease traceability, which we are again talking about here at this conference. As we start looking at those opportunities to move forward, partnerships with your organizations, partnerships with states, and even partnerships with private industry are going to be key, so I look forward to that. When Secretary Perdue became Secretary of the Department of Agriculture last April, he stated very early on that his vision was for USDA to be the most efficient, most effective, and most customer-focused agency in the federal government. And since that time, we've taken steps, or he's taken steps, to ask the leadership at USDA as well as the career employees to look at how we can embrace that concept and listen to farmers and ranchers and industry across America to be able to roll back regulations that have been cumbersome to them and also be receptive and open to changes in regulation or new regulations that will facilitate growth in our agricultural industry, which is kind of a tough line to follow. Since that time, USDA has rolled back nearly $58 million worth of regulation, and we continue to look forward to adhering to President Trump's directive to, as we introduce one new dollar of regulation costs, that we roll back $2 of regulation costs. And so we want to partner with you to find those opportunities, but by working together with teamwork, transparency, consistency and objectivity, we feel confident that we can continue to put together the right plans and make the right decisions. So as I'm visiting with you today, I'd like to talk about several main topics and headings that I think fit together that aren't all directly animal disease traceability, but all are part of the family that encompasses the influences that are out there as we consider animal disease traceability. And first of those is something that's being talked about in D.C. right now is the new Farm Bill. And within the principles of the Farm Bill that USDA released at the end of January, some of the ones that are most relevant to animal agriculture are that they include that we want to enhance partnerships and the scientific tools necessary to prevent and mitigate and, where possible, eradicate pests and diseases, and that we also want to make a priority at USDA out of safeguarding the domestic food supply and protecting animal health through modernizing the tools needed to bolster biosecurity prevention, surveillance, emergency response, and border security. And so as we think about that more specifically, and we think about what the livestock industry has been talking to Congress about in the form of an animal disease component that may include a vaccine bank, USDA is really approaching our conversations with Congress and our conversations with the industry from a three-legged stool approach. And the first leg on that stool would be the prevention, preparedness, and response. And it would really be something that would be similar to what might bring us to parity in the livestock industry with what the Farm Bill did for the plant industry several Farm Bills ago, where they established the 10007, what we in USDA call the 10007 program for plants. This would put a similar program in place in the animal industry that would allow us to focus on prevention, detection, and then prepare us for outbreaks that would allow us to react in a decisive manner if we did identify a disease in America. And specifically, those components that we would be most interested in bringing forward through that type of a philosophy would be surveillance to make sure that we find diseases faster, prevention through enhanced detection to make sure that we're looking for those high-risk entry points and watching them, outreach to producers and the public on biosecurity. I think, you know, as we've aggressively pursued trade and hosted lots of trade groups from foreign countries, I think we've lost sight a little bit of, you know, how long was it since they were last in their pig barn in China, and now they're in our pig barn in America. And there's some things that I think we can do to think about some basic biosecurity steps that might go a long ways in helping us be more prepared, which will include training exercises, response plan development, and also having equipment placed around in places where we can have access to it when we need it. We learned that through avian influenza, that having equipment where it needed to be in a timely manner became a real hurdle, and in some cases became a problem to us in being able to address the needs, the immediate needs that were taking place. Many of you come from states that you know, have smaller livestock industries or may not have financial resources available to have a full complement of veterinarians on staff at the state level. And so we would also want to work with you to be able to help address that need and to be able to have a veterinarian infrastructure that would be available. And then we also want to have rapid response plans available, as well as continue to look for new diagnostic methods and new treatment methods for diseases. The second leg of that stool would be the National Animal Health Laboratory Network. And this would be to continue to develop and help states work through getting local diagnostic abilities closer to the producers that might be looking for them and closer to the animal populations that we want to be able to run those diagnostic tests for. You know, as a past director in the state of Nebraska, I know that producers are more willing and interested in sending a sample to the University of Nebraska than they are to send it to Plum Island and the federal government. And so as we can partner with states to develop local capabilities, I think we'll have producers embrace those opportunities to make sure that we're getting rapid submission of samples and rapid diagnosis at a more local level. And then finally, the third leg of that stool would be the vaccine bank. And initially, that discussion has focused on FMD vaccine, but I think it's also important to remember that there's other diseases out there in other species that it might be prudent to have supplies of vaccine available for, and would also be something important to consider. But at the end of the day, we still at USDA consider that first leg, that surveillance and prevention leg, to be the most important and most effective leg that we can develop. Because even if we have a vaccine bank, that means that we've had an occurrence of the disease of FMD or some other disease that probably has eliminated a big chunk of our export market opportunities. And so we've already felt the effects of that, and even though we have the tools to maybe go out and combat it, it would be way better off if we were able to prevent it in the first place. And so that's where animal disease traceability also comes into play. If we do have a disease occur, we need to identify that disease early, and we need to take steps rapidly to respond and mitigate the impacts of that animal disease. And you and I both know that disease traceability is the critical component to ensuring that we're able to do that. And it's also, going to disease traceability. We saw last year as we were debating and making the negotiations to open the Chinese market to U.S. beef. Once again, our traceability programs provided one of the biggest challenges over the 2 or 3 or 14 years of discussions to open that marketplace back up after BSE. And so while the pork and poultry industries have made great strides in animal disease traceability, we still have some challenges in my industry, or the industry I claim the most, the beef industry, in catching up. But I think the encouraging thing that we've heard out of the beef industry over the last few years, and even more so in the last few months, is a real openness to engage in that dialogue and to be part of the discussions and look at what is what's possible and what we might can do. And while we've been working on this topic for 14 or maybe even 20 years, it seems like the same 14 points that we've settled on after the last round of listening sessions are the same 14 points that we've been talking about. And so we need to figure out a way forward, a way to make progress, a way to get past those same discussions that we've been having. And so as we've worked together at USDA, we've come up with a vision for what we think USDA might could do to try to facilitate some steps forward in animal disease traceability. And so what we're looking to do now is maybe get out of some of the mechanical discussions of how animal disease traceability works, get out of the technology discussion, and turn that over to the industry to decide what technologies are going to work in industry, and let industry develop either the current technology that is preferred, or the current technologies that are preferred, or maybe a whole new one that will work better. And so basically what we're going to do at USDA is we're going to tell you what information we want to be able to access and when over time, and figure out how we can implement that and together with you to be able to accomplish that. Initially, what we're going to be asking for is the ability for animals that move into interstate commerce to be able to be traced to a farm of birth. And we're asking the industry to help us identify a method to be able to retire those animals when they're harvested. And so in between those points, there are other opportunities to collect touch points, to collect data, to add to that traceability chain. But initially, we want to start out with the bookends and work to the center. And the industry itself, you're already capturing some of that information in as we move through that process. As animals move through interstate commerce, the health certificate system also captures data that can be included there. And we're looking to also work to make that a more robust system, make electronic health certificates work better and to work with industry to develop those technologies that will help us embrace state needs as well as federal needs as we look at that, that traceability chain that could be used in the event of an animal disease outbreak. And so pretty soon we're going to be putting out our request for proposals. Last night I had several people come up and ask me about when that was coming out. And so those, the request for proposals will be coming out soon, but we're wanting to focus on those parts that I just mentioned, the bookends and health certificates, as we look forward to trying to build a system and allow the industry to fill in the gaps. And how we develop that framework to be able to have information stored privately in private databases and build the access portals that the federal and state animal health officials can access are also going to be important and very much of interest to us in those agreements. We're also excited to announce that we're going to be doing a special pilot project with the state of Kansas. Jackie McClaskey, their director of agriculture, and her department of agriculture has stepped forward, identified a partnership with the Kansas Livestock Association and Kansas State University to put together a pilot project that might look about how the industry is working today, what touch points that they need to strengthen and identify, and how we can gather that information, share that information on maybe a state basis, and they're going to be putting together cooperators, and we're going to be one of those partners with them, not only in putting together the vision for that that pilot project, but also in helping them fund that pilot project at USDA. And so as we move forward, I think and disease traceability system will help us, but we also need to be reaching out to producers and talking to them about biosecurity, and that's something that I mentioned earlier on in the talk here a little bit, and because the best way to combat disease is to prevent it in the first place. And so we want to work with you as partners again to put together federal and state biosecurity plans that also reach out and touch individual producers and help them think about what they're doing on their farms and ranches. And that not only includes states, but it can include species groups and organizations that touch individual members at the state and local and federal level as well. And so as we know, and as you've heard before, but I want to reinforce, I think biosecurity programs are going to become much more important, especially as we're being told by OMB that that's going to be part of indemnity programs and qualification for indemnity programs in your states in the future. So as we know, those indemnity programs have become more and more expensive because larger and larger herds are impacted by that, just the nature of how we move livestock around. And so brucellosis and tuberculosis, especially tuberculosis and FMD in the future, those indemnity programs are going to be tied to having some kind of a state system in place. And that's part of being responsible to taxpayers, and it's also part of being responsible as animal health officials to the producers in our nation and in our individual states, if you're a state veterinarian. And so that states and producers that don't have biosecurity programs in place run the risk of not being eligible for indemnity programs down the roads. And so this is going to require states to include traceability in each state itself, as well as holding other states around them accountable for diseased animals that may cross state lines or animals that may be exposed to diseases that show up later as they cross state lines. And so this includes, animals in interstate commerce and for food animals, but also we need to look at breeding animals and intact females that could become breeding animals down the road as well. And then finally, the last thing I want to talk to you before that last little segment probably inspired some questions, but I want to talk to you about one more thing before we get to that opportunity for you to ask me those questions, is in the Farm Bill, under the President's, not in the Farm Bill, but under the President's budget, is included a proposal that would move the National Bio-Agro Defense Facility, NBAF, from the Department of Homeland Security to USDA and the oversight of that. Under that proposal, the Department of Homeland Security would finish the build-out of that facility. They would be responsible for decommissioning Plum Island, where those facilities currently are located. But as we work to the startup projected in 2023 of that facility, ARS and APHIS would become partners in operating that facility, much the way we operate the facilities in Ames, Iowa, as partners today. And as you know, USDA has been very involved on a day-to-day basis with the operation of Plum Island. So this isn't casting us into a new area that we're unfamiliar with. So we feel quite confident that we will be able to not only embrace the operation of NBAF, but also embrace the vision that Senator Roberts had when he envisioned a national bio and agri defense facility that had its eye on the food supply and food security, as well as reaching out into other areas of research and cooperation with not only at the federal level, but at state and local level as well. And we think that this is kind of the final piece in the four things, that the other three things I talked to you about today, that all go together and work well together to be able to support animal agriculture and support animal health across our United States. And so we look forward to continuing to work with Congress, work to make sure that funding is provided to USDA that would allow us to be able to look long-term and know that it wouldn't infringe on the other programs that are within USDA. And that's something that in the conversations I have had on Capitol Hill is very important to them as well, to make sure that the funding follows that transfer so that it allows USDA to continue its important work that we do today, as well as embrace this. So thank you for the opportunity to be able to share some of these thoughts with you. If there's still time, I'm very much willing to answer a few questions.
You have a question or two? Test? Okay. Thanks for coming today. Really appreciate your comments.
Hi.
Just a question about that, about the indemnity piece, and I follow the logic of ensuring that producers are watching out for themselves and have good biosecurity plans. As those plans are developed, as far as how that's tied to indemnity, I think it's important to keep in mind, at least historically anyway, that indemnity has been not for the benefit necessarily of the producer who's affected, because they're going to be out of business. That indemnity doesn't really make them whole. You know, the reason we indemnify and remove those animals is for the benefit of the rest of the industry in the area. So, you know, it kind of, you know, as an example, if you were a livestock producer in an area, and we'll just use worst case scenario and say your neighbor next door had poor biosecurity practices, which as you talk to neighbors, livestock producers, everybody's neighbor is worse operator than they are, right? I hear that quite often anyway. But so if your neighbor is a poor operator and they get foot and mouth disease, and there is some requirement for biosecurity that poor operator does not meet, it's really to the, you know, disadvantage to the neighbors that may be doing things right. So I'm looking forward to being part of that conversation, and hopefully we can find ways forward that will, you know, continue to protect the good operators even in spite of those that may not have good biosecurity plans.
So your question really is focused on the end of the equation and we want to focus on the beginning of the equation. Your neighbor won't have bad biosecurity practices if, by working together as a federal government and a state animal health official, working with the South Dakota cattle organizations, that we engage in a conversation that helps them understand, you know, what they can do on their individual farms and ranches, and what we can do as state and federal partners to get that message out and put that structure in place. You know, so at the end of the day, the desire would be that we create an environment where, you know, we mitigate the opportunities for FMD, TB, brucellosis to manifest itself and spread in the first place, and that indemnity really isn't what we're looking for as our first line of defense to protect our animal industry or our friends and neighbors. It's the last alternative because we've invested in the other alternatives first.
Julie Smith at the University of Vermont. I appreciate your mentioning the foot-and-mouth disease vaccine bank, and I think that's an important step. When I've talked with dairy producers about the potential for a disease like that, and I ask them what they want, they all raise their hand and say, I want vaccine. And they want it right then if it was going on. They don't want to have to wait weeks. So I'm wondering what steps are being done to make sure that we don't just have a vaccine bank, but that we have access to the manufacturing capacity and the distribution channels to get it there when we need it, if we need it.
So, you know, there's a lot that goes into that. And first of all, you know, if we do have foot and mouth disease, we have implications to trade there. If we're able to stomp it out without using vaccines, our options to reopen trade are different than when we start using vaccine. And so there's important considerations as we go along that decision timeline as a nation, if we do have to face that decision timeline. And so, category one or two outbreak of FMD, I think our first desire as industries and a nation is try to stomp it out without using vaccine. It's when if we could have it, contain it, and localize it. As it spreads to multiple states or multiple regions of the United States, then, of course, vaccine is going to be something that could be a useful tool. You know, the amount of livestock that are in America and the challenge of having a vaccine bank that would have vaccine available to everybody right away is, you know, it's the cost of that is probably not a realistic investment when we look at the other options and other programs that livestock producers may want to implement. And so we need to continue to think about that way. The other side of that coin, the other part of your question was, ARS has invested in research for other vaccine alternatives. We have a partnership with a large pharmaceutical company that has been developing that here in the United States, and we're continuing to move forward with that research, as well as entering into discussions with international providers that would be options as we look down the road.
We're out of time, so Undersecretary, I'd like to